My name is Dr. Neil Stone. I'm an infectious diseases physician and a clinical researcher based at St. George's, University of London, in the United Kingdom. Our study, published in the March edition of the Journal of Clinical Investigation, studied the evolution of drug resistance in cryptococcal meningitis. This deadly infection is caused by the fungus Cryptococcus neoformans. This organism is widespread in the environment and is usually harmless to healthy individuals. However, in the immunosuppressed, such as those with advanced HIV/AIDS, it can cause a deadly infection of the central nervous system. It is particularly common in sub-Saharan Africa, where the vast majority of the estimated 200,000 cases per year are seen. Patients present with severe headaches, fever, confusion, seizures, and sometimes even coma. Untreated, cryptococcal meningitis will lead to death. Treatment is possible, although remains difficult. The current gold standard treatment is 2 weeks of a combination of amphotericin B and flucytosine, followed by a long course of fluconazole. However, in low resource settings, including much of sub-Saharan Africa, which, as I mentioned, also sees the most number of cases, fluconazole is the only available treatment. In these settings, giving an IV therapy, such as amphotericin B, is often simply not feasible, and flucytosine is not available at all. Fluconazole has the advantage that it can be given orally, is relatively inexpensive, and is widely available. Unfortunately, we know that treatment outcomes using fluconazole as monotherapy to treat cryptococcal meningitis are very poor. Over half the patients receiving this single drug therapy will not survive beyond 3 months. Until now, it was assumed that fluconazole monotherapy led to such poor treatment outcomes was because the drug is fungostatic, which means that it stops the replication of the organism rather than kills it. This therefore means that it is slow to clear the infection from the central nervous system. Our study investigated, for the first time in humans, the contribution of a phenomenon known as heteroresistance to treatment failure. Heteroresistance is when a few cells, usually less than 1% of the total, within an otherwise sensitive population of Cryptococcus, are resistant to fluconazole. This is prior to any drug exposure. This can simply be shown by plating the organism onto plain agar, which you can see here in this photograph on the left, and on the right, with the drug fluconazole added. You can see that only a small percentage of cells are able to grow on the plate which has had fluconazole added to it. This is heteroresistance, and importantly, would not be picked up on standard sensitivity testing. Previous studies in a mouse model of cryptococcal meningitis showed that when fluconazole treatment is given as a single agent, the proportion of these resistant cells increases over time. This raised fears that the resistant population could eventually come to dominate, causing frank drug resistance and therefore treatment failure. But the role of this in human cryptococcal meningitis had up till now never been investigated. We followed 20 patients in Tanzania, East Africa, who were HIV positive and are being treated for cryptococcal meningitis. Taking regular samples of cerebrospinal fluid via lumbar puncture, such as the procedure shown in this photograph, we cultured the organism directly from the patient's CSF onto standard agar plates, as well as on those which contain the drug fluconazole, using the technique shown previously. This allowed us to observe whether A, there was a resistant subpopulation at the start of treatment, and B, to see if it increased as a proportion of the total during therapy. By observing the total and resistant populations of cells over time, we could see that there was indeed a resistant subpopulation in all cases at baseline, and in patients receiving fluconazole alone, the proportion of resistant cells in the CSF increased over time, as you can see in this graph. Moreover, we found that in a subset of patients who received combination therapy with fluconazole and flucytosine, the resistant population was suppressed entirely, as is shown here. Additionally, we saved the isolates of Cryptococcus from the study, and, along with our colleagues in the UK and Israel, performed next-generation whole genome sequencing. This revealed that the resistant cells often had aneuploidy, or an imbalance in the number of chromosomes. Cryptococcus has 14 chromosomes and is normally haploid, which means it normally has one copy of each chromosome. We found that the drug-resistant colonies often had disomy, which is a duplication of a whole chromosome. And we found this most commonly in chromosome 1, as you can see here in this diagram. Importantly, this is the chromosome where the gene for the fluconazole drug target lies, as well as a gene known to be important in drug resistance by way of a drug efflux pump. We were also able to show that cells with this change in chromosome 1 copy number did indeed efflux more than those which did not. And this is shown in this graph here. This is, to our knowledge, the very first study to describe this type of drug resistance in human cases of cryptococcal meningitis. As things stand, fluconazole remains the only antifungal available across much of Africa to treat this deadly form of meningitis. Our unique study provides a mechanistic explanation for why fluconazole as a monotherapy performs so poorly, and in combination with a large clinical trial by our research group, supporting the combination of fluconazole and flucytosine, can help us advocate for wider access to antifungals such as flucytosine to be made available urgently for the treatment of cryptococcal meningitis. I would like to thank the senior authors on this paper, Dr. Tihana Bicinic and Professor Judith Berman. I would also like to thank the Wellcome Trust Strategic Award for Medical Mycology and Fungal Immunology, who funded this study. And on behalf of all my co-authors, I thank you for your attention.